Thank you. Thank you. So good morning, everybody, and thank you for joining me here. I'm here to talk to you about cloud security. And I have this great casino story I'm going to tell at the end of my talk. And before then, I'm just going to sort of take you on a journey that I have gone through over the last 4 years as I have achieved what I like to call cloud enlightenment. And so I want to really talk to you ultimately about securing the future. Because securing the future is going to be very different from what it's been like securing the past and securing the present. Technology is changing. Our architecture, most importantly, our architectures are changing all around us. And I really believe that traditionally, as security practitioners, we have been slaves to our architecture, and it has not been the other way around. And in the future, our architecture is changing. We're all moving to the cloud. Right? That's inevitable. There are going to be some holdouts for a few more years here and there in specific verticals, but I've watched over the last 5 years this mass exodus to the cloud and this mass extinction of the old way of doing things. And what I mean by the old way of doing things is where you are responsible for things that are not your core competency, where you are a mobile app developer who is somehow also responsible for ping power and pipe, where you are delivering services to your customers and you have a bunch of people on your staff who are just keeping up the infrastructure and have nothing to do with really delivering that service to your customers. And so that way of operating is going away. That is being replaced with cloud architectures, and we need to be ready for that. We need to be able to secure, whether we like the cloud or not, whether we think that this is a good move or a bad move, it's happening. It's inevitable. It's upon us. And so for us to be ready to secure that future, we need to understand where we're failing now in the present. And we are failing now in the present. We are not ready for the massive scale that is already here and that is only going to exponentially increase in the coming years. And I say we're not ready, I mean we as an information security community, we as practitioners, we are not doing an awesome job of securing the present, are we? There are all of these media-worthy breaches, right? Target, Home Depot, Anthem, right? One after the other after the other. I can think back all the way to Heartland Systems years ago. It was one of the first real media-worthy breaches, right? And since then, it's been no more than a couple months between them. Well, what is causing all of these breaches? And these are not cloud companies, right? These are not cloud architectures. These are traditional architectures, right? These are old-fashioned enterprise companies running old-fashioned enterprise databases on old-fashioned enterprise operating systems. And so if we can't do that, if we can't secure that past and that present, what are we going to do with the future? Well, really, it's about fundamentals. What we need to do now, what we're going to need to do going forward, is get much better at our fundamentals. Embracing cloud security, embracing cloud architectures, is not going to be about some radical revolution. We don't need to necessarily change everything about the way we think about security. We need to go back. We need to go back to our fundamentals and actually do them right. And we're not doing them right now. We're not doing our basic access controls. We're not doing our basic monitoring. We're not doing the right encryption. And the reason we're not doing this is because we've been outscaled. There are too many services running on too many ports, on too many servers, serving too many users. And we don't have, there are 200,000 open info security jobs in the US right now. We don't have the staff, we don't have the manpower to go and close all the ports, to lock down all the permissions, to put in all the firewall rules. Our architectures are built such that we've got our security only at choke points, where we've got a firewall and an IDS hanging off of a big switch at a massive choke point somewhere in our network. Well, then we're limited by that architecture. There are only so many packets that we can pull off that one span port on our Cisco router in the core of our network, right? We're not doing deep packet inspection on all of our packets. We're taking maybe a fraction of them, right? Because we are a slave to that architecture. We're not doing our fundamentals. And we know what those fundamentals are. If we think back to Alexander the Great, he could look down over a battlefield from on top of a hill and see that there was a chariot commander down there that he wanted to flank to the west. What would he do? He would pull out his little encoder ring, substitution hash, but it was state of the art at the time, best practices. Pull out his little substitution hash, secret encoder ring, get a piece of papyrus, encrypt a message, roll it up, seal it with a wax seal, therefore authenticating that message and making it tamper-proof, hand that to a trusted messenger, send him down the hill to the chariot commander. The chariot commander would authenticate the message by verifying the wax seal, verify that the message hadn't been tampered with, open it up, pull out his decryptor ring, decrypt the message, and stab the messenger in the throat. So we have understood how to deal with sensitive information in hostile environments and open networks and public spaces for thousands of years. And we're still not doing it right. We're still not taking all the right steps. And that is because we have been outscaled by our architecture. We all know what we want to do. We all know that we want every service locked down to a non-privileged user. We know that we want all of those operating system privileges for that user locked down as much as possible. We know that we want only services that are on some whitelist that are registered somewhere to be able to talk on the network, and only to other services that are registered. We know that we don't want any random packets. We don't want people being able to hop from one box to another and engage in lateral movement. We know all of these things, but how many of us are doing all of them? Very, very few. And that's because of the limitations of our architecture, the limitations of our environment, which really come down to limitations in the way that we've been thinking. I've spent much of my career working in and around rooms much like this one here, the secure data center. And I put that in air quotes for a reason. Having worked in data centers for 17 years, I don't think of them as particularly secure, right? As I said, we've got problems with span ports. We've got problems with all of this architecture. Because a big data center like this can really be thought of as one giant server, as one big box, right? There's only so much memory in that box. There's only so much hard drive space in that box. There's only so much bandwidth in and out of that box, this one giant PC. And you've got people on your staff who know just how raised the floors need to be, and they know all about rack density and wattage and British thermal units and the air conditioning requirements, none of which has anything to do with delivering your service. But you have these experts on staff who know all about it. And you learn to think inside this box. This is your environment. This is what you're living with. This is what you're dealing with, right? This is, I have to secure this given these constraints. Given that amount of hardware, given that amount of span ports, given that amount of bandwidth, that amount of CPU cycles, what can I do to best compromise and secure this as best I can, given what they're allowing me to have as part of this architecture, right? So we are a slave to this box. We've been a slave to this room. And even worse than that, we start to think to ourselves, well, if only I could own a bigger chunk of that box. If only I could get a bigger box inside my box inside my box. And I actually was responsible for procuring a box not unlike this not too long ago in my career. And I bought a box like this just to do deep packet inspection for one application. And the back of this box was filled with Intel 4-port NICs. I'm sure many of you know that card, right? And the back of it lit up like a Christmas tree. It was beautiful. And I would sit and have lunch on the other side of the glass that looked into the server room, and I would just look at this big box. We named it Zeus, right? A lot of us in the industry have things with mythology, right? So this was Zeus. This was the big, powerful, the god box. And this was going to solve all of our problems. Well, actually, it was able to do deep packet inspection for about 20% of the traffic that we needed to watch for one application. It's a compromise. It was a lot better than the 5% we were able to do with a smaller box inside the box. And this is what we've learned to accept and live with. This is my budget. Now I'm stuck with this for 36 months until accounting decides that I've used it, that I've depreciated it enough, right? And I started with 20%, right? And it took me maybe 6 months to buy that box. So by the time I've even implemented this, we've probably already released two new versions of our software. our business model might have changed. We've got new customers. We've got new end users. We've got new employees. This box never was big enough. It never fit. Before we even finished buying it, this box was obsolete. Our business keeps moving forward, but our boxes are on 36-month depreciation cycles. And that just doesn't work. These are some of the core reasons why we're seeing these big media-worthy breaches. We are thinking inside these boxes. We don't have the right resources. And our businesses are growing, our services are growing, and we've been totally outscaled by the business that we're doing. So then what? Well, I came to Sumo Logic 4 years ago, just a little over that. And I came out of a career working in secure data centers, everything from government, managed security providers, very secure data centers. And I came to Sumo Logic. They told me, the founders told me, this is a cloud-first company. We're a cloud company. And I came with a secret agenda. I was going to convince them to buy a colo in an Exodus data center somewhere so that we could really secure it. I had this fantastic opportunity to come to a greenfield company. They didn't really have a product yet. They didn't really have a website yet. And here I was coming in as head of security very early on in a company's history. And so I'm thinking, all right, I'm gonna do this my way. I'm going to talk these guys out of this ridiculous cloud thing because the cloud's insecure. I had bought all the FUD, all the hype. The cloud's insecure. I didn't know why. I just knew it was. And so we're going to run in a data center. We're going to do this the good old-fashioned way, and I'm going to build a box. And I'm going to put a box inside that and a box inside that, and it's all going to be good. We're going to do this my way. Because I had developed a philosophy. After many, many years in this business, I had developed a philosophy. Everything least privilege, everything whitelist only and default deny, right? Don't run any process that you don't fully understand. Don't allow any network traffic you don't fully understand. Block everything that is not explicitly allowed, right? And I never got to do it. I never got to do it. And I knew it was right, but they wouldn't ever let me do it. Well, now, startup. Great. Employee number 11. Let's do it. We're going to do it my way. And I start really thinking about it, putting it up on the whiteboard and thinking about the complexities of it. And the whole time while I'm scheming, how can I convince these guys to do this in a data center instead of AWS? Our chief architect, a guy named Stefan, brilliant guy, is going on and on and on about these AWS APIs and all this cool stuff that he can do with automation. And I was just really, honestly, I was just kind of half listening for the first couple of months. Just, yeah, whatever, you know, skinny pants, San Francisco, you know, cloud stuff, whatever. I'm security, right? Old fashioned. We're going to do this the right way. And as I'm standing at the whiteboard, looking at this huge mess that I've drawn for how I'm going to enact my philosophy of least privilege and whitelist only and every process we understand in this very complicated system that Sumo Logic has built, I realize I can't do it. I can't do it. And finally, I hear Stefan's words start to echo around in my head about, you know, elasticity and how everything is just code. And how the programmer might make a mistake, but the code never makes a mistake. And if we want to do something to 1,000 boxes or 10,000 boxes or 100,000 boxes, the same way each and every time, he's got code that he's built to do that. And I had this moment. I saw something that I could never unsee. And that was that this cloud was really a huge amorphous blob of power that I could warp to my will using code. That everything that I wanted to implement, every host firewall, host intrusion detection system, file integrity monitoring on everything, everything whitelisted, default denied, alert on any stray packet that does that I don't know about, wake me up in the middle of the night for a single packet because it shouldn't be there, that I could do that with these APIs. That I could do that in AWS in a way that I was never able to do in a data center. And even now, given the greenfield opportunity to build one myself, I realized I wouldn't be able to do it. And I saw suddenly this tremendous opportunity that I had to enact my philosophy and to get ahead of that curve. And so that's what we did. And so now on the other side, I have this environment. I've never been prouder of anything in my life than the security we have at Sumo. There's not a single packet on that network that I don't understand. There's not a single user doing anything that they're not allowed to do. Everything file integrity monitoring, every port lockdown, every operating system permission lockdown, across 6,000 servers worldwide. We're ingesting many, many terabytes of data a day, around 50 terabytes of data a day, 6,000 servers in 3 countries all around the world, and everything is as secure as anything I have ever seen in my entire 17, 18 years in this business. I would put our security up against any government data center. And we're doing it all in the cloud. And then people will talk, I read these FUD articles about cloud security and how the cloud isn't secure, and I get angry now. Because these people who are talking about this, I'm sure they're not doing everything that we're doing. I'm sure that they do not have the controls in place that we have in place. And so this is the way that I like to explain it to less technical people, right? This is what I like to say to the business people. Say, I understand gambling, and I understand human psychology, and I got a little bit of money, and I want to go into business. I want to have a business that provides some entertainment and makes me a good deal of money, high profit margin. So I buy a card table and a little umbrella and a deck of bicycle cards, and I go out and I play 3-card Monty out on the street. And this is like our traditional data center. I have a lot of control. I built the card table. I've got a buddy in the audience who's going to say what I want him to say. There's a little hole in the table I put there myself. I marked the cards just right. I know everything about this environment. This is my data center with my Zeus box. And this is about the scale. This is pretty accurate, that I can handle, right? If I have to control absolutely everything myself in that manner with my own two hands, this is about what I can do. That's about how much money I can make. There's another business model that also provides some entertainment and makes me some good profit margin. Doing the same thing, but without all that control, on a totally different scale. In order to get this scale, in order to make this kind of money serve that many users, you need to think differently about it. You need to give up that Zeus box and understand that sometimes a slot machine is going to pay out. Sometimes a blackjack dealer might actually cheat the house. But statistics, math, powers of scale are going to make sure that you win at the end of the day, every day. Right? If these guys can do it, if they can run security that way, if they can make money that way without that every hands-on, then so can we. It's the same model. It's the same idea of scale and statistics that once you see, you won't be able to unsee. You'll be able to embrace. And so I can talk a great talk, right? But where's the proof? Well, we recently went through a PCI DSS service provider level 1, right? The absolute tip of the pyramid of PCI. Gartner says that most enterprises spend $750,000 to achieve that certification. Usually they spend about $120,000 just on scoping. We did the whole thing for $60,000, half what most people pay for scoping. Why? Well, first of all, evidence collection took me about an hour because I just had to run one single script, all my 6,000 servers, gave up all their configurations, everything was perfect. No exceptions. Evidence collection. For technical test matrix, 1 hour. Right? This was simply a validation of everything that we were already doing. And so if you are running in a traditional data center and you think that you can go through that kind of audit and that kind of time and only spend that kind of money to do it, well, then you're probably doing okay, but I bet you can't. I bet you can't keep up with us running an Amazon the way that we are right now. And so how do we apply this? How do we take this home? What do we do? Well, think about the power of platform and infrastructure as a service companies. Think about the power that they provide to you and think about how you can leverage that to do all of the stuff that you've always wanted to do but were never able to do. Right? What is your wish list? What is the brass ring? Think about how you can actually implement that because you can. That power is available to you now. And that's all. Thanks, everybody.